And the person who's going to be talking about this is Dr. Chris Duvall, who is from the Department of Geography, as you can see. He has done a lot of his work on looking at the geography of migration, especially plants. He tends to be fairly well known for working on marijuana for obvious reasons, but that is not all he works on. And also, I just want to mention that he's going to be looking at a lot of these plant migrations from Africa to the Americas, and he's also an Africanist. He has worked in Africa, he's lived in Africa. He was in Mali in the Peace Corps for several years as well. So without further ado, I will give you...
than Africans who worked with European scientists to develop their own material at which point maybe that would have been a portal for distributing that information.
Yeah, and that's a really important element of thinking about how the documents came to us. And historically there was an incredible amount of this knowledge of these Africans. The Europeans might have worked together, but the Africans didn't care, right? For perfect reason. There's a woman that published, she read her, I think it's not pronounced, who is at Stanford, and she started to do research and looking at the knowledge circulates. And basically, she was able to reconstruct a couple of plant histories saying, look, things to do about this plant. You can tell from this, and this. And look, this European resident in the United States did not see that information. Right? And so you're happy to do that. But a lot of it traces to kind of newer scholarship, too, just to make up in the
You had a lot of examples of like the spiritual aspects of plants, and I was wondering if you have any examples or if you know why there's not really any concepts of like Europeans doing that same thing where like yams are special in Nigeria, okra is special. Like, why do Europeans not really have like the concept?
Yeah, they do. They do. And so a lot of ideas about for instance. Monster is a widespread need and people like this is horrible, it should be taken out. Well, it was used a lot for a couple reasons. One, it grew really easily, so the Spanish were traveling with scattered seeds, and so the next year people were able to be able to follow that sort of pathway. But it was also significant in terms of Christian belief systems that were reproduced in California. And so it was a way of kind of expressing religious information as well as giving a way finding field. But there's a lot of plants, people brought flowers to plant, even though these weren't necessary to live on. Right? People would bring flowers up and they would want to plant and reproduce settlements that have meaning in terms of their ornament and stuff like that. So there are those histories. I don't study them, so I don't know them very well. But they're there also. And a lot of times that's neglected because the emphasis has been on looking at commercial economies, not subsistence economies. And there were subsistence practices within European communities as well.
What you said about cannabis reminded me of how the coca leaves are used to sustain hunger and altitude and also to motivate, but it's not what we usually think of with cannabis. You seem to suggest that the social context affects it, but if there does seem to be, if the medicinal uses of cannabis suggest that it does increase appetite instead of, so it seems to have the opposite effect of, and also when you said to motivate work, those are things that we do associate with the coca leaf, but not so much with cannabis.
I'm roasting that.
Yeah, I'm helping.
Our kids go.
So
the shallow deep dive into cannabis, right? So if you go into cannabis culture, there's kind of two different general types that you get, mid-presence and deep, right? And these are recognized by their effects, their subjective effects. Even if the types of cannabis where it's a pseudo sedative, that has a distinct biogeographic history that doesn't have to be tested for an African. It's a sativa variety, right? It's considered a pseudo stimulant, does have to be tested for an African. So the people who are using it to motivate, if you talk to people who are using it to motivate, sativa is something that they'll use before coming to class, right? They'll use it before going to work. They'll use it to kind of get up. The other genetic pattern here is that in southern Africa, there's a subgroup of sativa that has a THCV, tetrahydrocannabinol, which is cannabinoid, which is actually appetite suppressant. And so all the descriptions we have historically of people with this kind of appetite that actually using cannabis are in the context of appetite suppression. All of the historic evidence that we have of appetite stimulation is associated with different parts of the world, particularly parts of South America, parts of North Africa, and elsewhere. So there's additional evidence that suggests that there is an objective reason to kind of these effects that people have shown. But for cannabis, the social context aspect of it is really powerful compared to other drugs. Coca is a very different, of course, chemically. It also has a social context that is associated with more stimulation in some context, but also with kind of relaxation. It helps you stay away from talk at night, even though you're tired. That sort of thing. The pharmacology of it, clearly we know, just taking that pharmacology and putting it on this part of the
question. So there was a talk a few weeks ago about using genetic markers to follow migration patterns in Europe, and you talked about the genetic markers for the plants as well. The person who talked about the European situation with actual people migration mentioned how there's some things he can't touch because it's too delicate a political question. You can't figure out, you can't start talking about who is in Hungary at what time, or else it upsets a lot of people. Does that ever come up with plants? Is there any sort of symbolic nationalism or something along those lines?
I'm sure there is. For example, the genetic analyses of plants have not been done as well as humans. There's obviously a lot more kind of less kind of racial segments for plants, and a big part of the concern about human genetics is providing the parent justification for racial elements. With plants, though, the history of rights, the history of rights in North America, for instance, was always portrayed as like these genius slave owners figuring out this really complex system of agriculture with a plant that we've never ever before seen. And so, the important part of her work is saying those stories still persist, right? Those stories still exist in slave moments because the European enslavers do this, that we have rights history in South Carolina and elsewhere. And so, by saying, look, no, if we look at the plants draw something different. The story that, that I work on, right? More genetics on cannabis here. The plant population in historic Europe was genetically not intoxicated, did not produce THC, right? And so if all these plants are going to these different parts of the Americas, how did they become psychoactive in the Americas? How is that explained? That's explained by saying, well, the Africans, the blacks, did something that the Europeans didn't. They didn't know how to use it as a drug, and so the drug's existence is a racial behavior that was interpreted. And so, counter-arguing that, saying, look, the plant is doing different things too. There was two different genetic kind of lineages of plants that people were interacting with, and the drug usages appeared where that plant appeared, not where certain racial groups appeared. Right? And so the plants have been more used and useful for challenging these ideas about human difference. And in this case, about blood uses as racial determinants. Very short answer to a very complicated question, but that's kind of how people are using it.
Any other questions? Okay,
thank you all.